Good evening, everyone. My name is Sibylle Eschapasse, and I am the president of the Association des Français Fonctionnaires Internationaux de New York, known as the AFIN Association. It is a great honor for me, personally, but also for the board of the AFIN Association, to welcome you all tonight for a very special screening of an extraordinary documentary named The Pursuit of Endurance on the Shoulders of Shackleton. A movie based on the idea of Le Cardi, directed by Bertrand Delapierre and produced by Sagax. So before to proceed with the screening itself, which will be followed by a session of questions and answers, I would like to make a few things. First and foremost, I would like to very warmly welcome and thank the permanent representative of France to the United Nations, His Excellency Mr. François Delattre, for not only placing this event under his high patronage, but also for being here with us tonight on the evening of the General Assembly. So merci, Ambassador Delattre. I would like also to thank very warmly Le Cardi for his generosity, sponsoring financially this event tonight, allowing a group of more than almost 600 people to watch his documentary in the beautiful room of the ECOSOC at the UN. Merci, merci beaucoup, Luc. Behind the podium, I would like also to thank two other people. First, I would like to thank Paul Walker, who's sitting on my left. Paul is a director of environmental security and sustainability from Green Cross International, and Paul came all the way from Washington to be with us tonight. Thank you very much, Paul. I also would like to thank very warmly David Porter, who is an atmospheric and oceanographic research scientist at the Columbia University and the Earth Institute. Thank you very much, David. In the audience, I'd like to thank very much the Deputy Consul General of France, the one and only Bernard Faro, who is with us tonight. Thank you very much. I would like also to thank the lovely Carole Maisonneuve from the French Mission for her continued support to the association, but also for her great help tonight. And also, a few units at the UN that I have to mention, special events units, facilities management services, as well as security. Each of them played a big role in the coordination of tonight's event. Also, I would like, of course, to thank the board of my association, the AFIN, and I have to nominate them, otherwise they will be very upset with me. I would like to nominate Hélène Bray, Bertrand Fro, Benjamin Saligna, Pascal Chaler, and Christine Lavergne. These colleagues actually contribute greatly to the AFIN, and I could not dream of a better team. I would like also to thank actually a few journalists who are actually with us in the room. Among them, I would like to acknowledge and thank Milene Fernandez from the Epoch Times, who is with us. I would like also to mention Celia de la Varenne, who actually is a journalist for Mediapart and Afrique Nouvelle, but also the president of the Stop Trafficking of People Foundation. And I would like also to thank Talal Alaj from Al Arabiya TV, who is with us tonight. And last but not least, I would like to thank each and every one of you for showing up tonight, for your interest in the documentary, and also obviously your interest in the global warming and climate change issue. So without any further delay, it is now my great pleasure and a great honor to invite the permanent representative of France to the United Nations, our dear friend, His Excellency Mr. François Delattre, to address the floor. Thank you.
Bonjour. Est-ce que vous m'entendez? Because it will be a long, long speech, so better if you can hear me. Ma chère Sibylle, mon cher Luc, chers amis, un mot simplement, parce que vous attendez tous le film, pour vous dire combien je suis heureux de vous accueillir ce soir dans ce temple de la communauté des nations, pour la projection d'un film extraordinaire, The Pursuit of Endurance. Le film que vous allez voir est en effet au sens propre, et Luc en dira un mot dans un instant, un film extraordinaire, réalisé par une équipe qui ne l'est pas moins. Je pense en particulier au réalisateur Bertrand Delapierre, je pense aussi au producteur Luc Hardy, un ami de longue date pour qui, je le dis devant vous tous, j'ai une profonde admiration. And here I would like to express my warmer thanks and congratulations to Luc, as we say in English, to Luc, the producer of this extraordinary film. Luc is, as you all know, a very successful entrepreneur and an incredibly talented explorer and environmental advocate. The fight to preserve the planet, the fight against climate change, which is an existential fight for each and every one of us, is the fight of Luc's life. And you will all see his contagious passion about it during the Q&A that will follow the screening. Je voudrais aussi remercier du fond du cœur l'Association des Français Fonctionnaires Internationaux de New York, et en particulier sa présidente, Sibylle Eschapasse, pour avoir pris l'initiative avec Luc de cette soirée exceptionnelle et pour l'avoir organisée avec lui. Un grand merci, ma chère Sibylle, à toi et à toute l'équipe de la FIN pour votre remarquable travail, pour votre engagement et pour avoir permis la soirée exceptionnelle de ce soir. Let me tell you in a word how delighted I am to introduce the screening of the Pursuit of Endurance here and now. Here in this symbolic venue of the United Nations, where the Concert of Nations operates. And now, because, sans employer de grands mots, humanity is at an intersection in 2015, a turning point that makes this documentary even more timely and important. While the film highlights an act of exceptional courage performed by Sir Ernest Shackleton, it also served as a very powerful testimony of the dreadful impact of climate change. Returning to the region where the vessel Endurance got caught up in ice in the early days of 1915, Luc Hardy and his crew became the first-hand witnesses of the dramatic changes that took place there in more than 100 years. 100 years might be more than a lifetime, but for our host planet, this is like a blink of an eye. And this film provides crystal clear evidence, if need be, of the very fast transformation at play. Our climate is changing much more quickly than we think. Human activity, by the way, is on both sides of the equation. Climate change is caused by human activity. It has been clearly demonstrated. But it will also result in tremendous adverse effects for humanity, which will affect disproportionately more the most vulnerable. That's what this movie is all about. And that's why the conference on climate change that will take place in Paris at the end of this year, in November and December, is critically important and actually so vital for the world. But we will make it. Here you understand and you know the long tradition of French modesty, of course, but we'll succeed all together. We need to succeed in Paris to limit temperature rise by 2 degrees centigrade. That's the goal. And for that, we need the commitment of all, the governments for sure, but also the local authorities, the business world, the civil society, and ordinary citizens. And I hope this extraordinary documentary will help us strengthen the commitment of each and every one of us and make it even more than it is our number one, number two, and number three priority. Mes chers amis, ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming the producer, entrepreneur, and leader, Luc Hardy.
Thank you, François, thank you, Sibylle, and Paul and David. Just a few words about the film itself. It's a 52-minute documentary, which I produced and financed is based on an expedition which I organized almost exactly a year ago, October, November 2014, in the Southern Ocean, north of the Antarctic continent. As François just mentioned, it's inspired by Sir Ernest Shackleton, who was an Anglo-British explorer of the early part of the 20th century. And he did set to cross Antarctica at the time through the South Pole. Unfortunately, it didn't work as well as he had planned. And his odyssey, now called the Endurance, became stuff of a legend. And we tried to, if not reproduce, at least go on some of his footsteps and footsteps of his team of 27 men. The important person here, who should be here tonight, is Bertrand de la Pierre, who was a fearless cameraman and a director for the documentaries. And fortunately for him, but unfortunately for us, he's in Iceland right now working on another expedition. I'd like to call, you know, what I do, these adventures and this documentary, scientific eco-adventure, and that's really what it is. There is a core of a science at the heart of the documentary. Actually, what we did was to benefit the United Nations World Climate Research Program in partnership with CNRS in France. We were nine of us, four French, four British, including two young soldiers, whom you'll discover. And just to make sure that British, French friendship would survive the trip, we also had the Swiss lady as a ninth person in the expedition. So I'll let you discover the documentary, and please stay, you know, as long as you can after the projection. There will be a Q&A session with all of us, and you're welcome to ask all the questions you'd like after the documentary. Thank you very much, and enjoy the show.
So we hope you enjoyed the documentary as much as I did. And as we did, we actually are going to proceed with a session of question and answers. But before to do so, we're going to have actually both Paul Walker and David Porter, who will make a few remarks. So first, we're going to start with Paul Walker, who is the Director of Environmental Security and Sustainability from Green Cross International.
Thank you. Thank you, Sibylle. Can people hear me if I lean over closely to the microphone? Can you hear me in the back? All right, great, okay. I'm really delighted to be here tonight and very impressed with the expedition and the film. So I think the real congratulations for this evening go to Luc Hardy and his whole crew that spent, how many weeks was it, Luc?
Six weeks.
6 weeks doing the expedition to the Antarctic. Green Cross International, with whom I work, has been very supportive and a partner, I know, with Luc and his team in this work. And I thought I would just say a couple of quick words about Green Cross. Many of you may not know about Green Cross. And I also wanted to say a couple of words about climate change, which is what this expedition was really all about. Green Cross was founded by a name you'll recognize, Mikhail Gorbachev, the former Soviet president, back in 1993. He was encouraged by the first Earth Summit in 1992 to form another global advocate, really, for the environment. And he gladly did that. Green Cross was created by a number of colleagues of Gorbachev from five countries. Russia, the United States, Japan, Switzerland, and the Netherlands in 1993. I joined the group in 1995. We are headquartered in Geneva, Switzerland, originally in The Hague, but Geneva typically between I think the Swiss and the Austrians and the Dutch. Geneva kind of stole the office away. So we've been in Geneva, Switzerland now for 20 years. We will celebrate our General Assembly, which is a meeting of all our affiliates now around the world, which are over 30, in about 2 weeks from now, I think the beginning of October. And we deal with a wide variety of issues, but I must say the one environmental issue that holds us all together is really climate change. If you read the latest international panel on climate change, you'll see that climate change is real, in spite of many of the climate deniers that we have in Washington, D.C. And I actually have managed the Washington, D.C. office for Gorbachev and Green Cross since 1996. I would urge all of you to get involved in this issue, not necessarily to do an expedition to the Antarctic, although I would love to be on something like that. I love skiing and I love sailing. I also love scuba diving. I've done those things all my life. Would love to go on one of these expeditions sometime. But the issue is really very serious, and I think more serious than most of us are ready to admit. Gorbachev, when he founded Green Cross back 22 years ago now, said, what we really need is value change. In other words, it's not just a question of promoting energy efficiency. It's not just a question of promoting sustainable energy. Not just a question of energy efficiency, of recycling, of all the environmental initiatives that we're all supportive of and work on. It's really a question of behavioral change of the human race. Because most climate change, global warming, emission of methane, carbon dioxide, other gases, is really brought about by humans. All the activities we do in the industrial and post-industrial age. So I would urge you all to commit some part of your life to doing all the small things that need to be done, but in particular to support the COP21 meeting in December in Paris, and also to argue for very strong climate change goals for all countries in the world, both in multilateral forums like we have here in the United Nations, but also individually and right down to our own individual behaviors. So I'll stop there, but congratulations, Luke. Wonderful, wonderful movie, wonderful expedition, and we're very, very proud of you and your colleagues. Thank you.
Hello. I'd also like to thank Luke, not only for that wonderful film, but also for organizing that expedition. The data that Zoe and the other expedition members collected are really crucial for scientists like myself to understand the oceans and the changes that are taking place there. So, as Sibylle said, my name is David Porter. I'm a research scientist at Columbia University here in New York City. My main area of expertise is ice-ocean interactions in both Greenland and Antarctica. And I use a couple different tools. I use computer models. I also take observations from aircraft and also more traditional techniques like from research vessels and ocean going vessels. In Greenland, I use small boats. So this is a project I'm excited about because what's great about Greenland is there's all these communities around the coast and there's very capable people living in these communities. And so as we saw in this film, these are very remote locations and they're hard to take observations. And so we think that by partnering with the local people there, we can both educate them about climate change, but also they can help us collect data that we can use for our science, but also then give back to them and help their fishing and hunting. In Antarctica, I've used both airplanes and ships. I went down to Antarctica this past March on the US icebreaker, the Nathaniel B. Palmer, where we studied. Previously, we thought East Antarctica was pretty insensitive to change, but in the past few years, the ice shelves in East Antarctica have been melting. And so they took this as a bit of a surprise. And so there's been some effort to go down there and measure the ocean and also the sea floor to understand why these changes are all of a sudden taking place. And so I just want to thank again, Luke, for taking these observations. And it's really going to help our science and understand how the different components of the climate system all fit together and interact. Thank you.
Thank you all. It's great, so many people here. And if it were not Rosh Hashanah, we would have probably double the number of people here tonight. So thanks again for coming. Just want to thank also the Focus on French Cinema Festival in Greenwich, New York, was held early April, where the film was first shown. And also the Angoulême Film Festival in France, where it was shown late August. It's also going to be shown in Geneva at the General Assembly of Green Cross on October 6th, if you happen to be in Geneva at that time or have friends there. And it's going to be shown also at the COP21 in Paris at the Grand Palais in early December. The main point here is to have you ask questions, especially if they are, you know, youngsters. I always love to interact with younger people, and they'll be the ones who will be most affected, and hopefully we'll find solutions to all the problems, you know, our generations and the other generations have created. So feel free to ask questions. Sibylle is going to explain in a second the how the system for Q&A works. So just one observation on climate change. People ask me often, you know, for example, you went South Georgia, did you see signs of climate change? So, you know, when you do one observation at one time, you don't see anything. You can only make conclusions if you compare with earlier observations, of course. But as an example, the beach where we end the expedition near Stromness was entirely covered by glacier 100 years ago when Shackleton did it. So he literally walked on ice there, and we were just on the beach, and the glacier that he walked on is about 3 kilometers away from where he walked himself. On South Georgia, you have there was a study a couple of years ago. They studied 36 of the 160 glaciers there. 28 are receding, 6 are neutral, not moving, and 2 are advancing. So the vast majority of these glaciers are just disappearing, as they are in the French Alps and in many, many places in the world. Sibylle, you want to explain how the Q&A would work if we have to pick the people here?
Absolutely. Now we're going to start with a session of question and answers. Most of you, except the people in the back of the room, have a microphone. You just have actually to raise your hand, and the system actually will focus on you, and you press the button on your left for the microphone, and Luc Hardy, Paul Walker, and David Porter will be here to answer your questions. Thank you.
Yeah, we can take any questions about the film, about climate change, about the science. Whatever you feel like asking is very informal, so don't feel intimidated by the room itself. It's just between friends.
I have a question on the left.
Okay, can you hear me? Okay, I'm Dr. Faraz Saleh, and I'm a senior research engineer, and my field is hydrology, so I've done modeling on climate change and I've used such data. And thank you, Luke, for this incredible film. And today, as you said, and as your other people said, climate change is real. It's a fact. It's not something we need to prove or believe in. It's there. But my question as a scientist, how can we bridge the gap? How can we bridge the gap between the scientific community, between the decision makers, politicians? We know it's a busy world. Today we have unemployment, we have economy, we have terrorist threats, we have refugees, we have the Middle East conflict, and I can go on. How can we prove, how can we bridge that gap between the scientific community, decision makers, politicians, and a simple person who all he's worried about is paying the bills at the end of the month? So this is my question as a scientist. I publish a paper, I write a paper, I get maybe 15 citations, 50 downloads, and that's where it stops. So if anyone has an answer for this question.
Well, you come in an expedition with me, and you will get much more coverage for the work you're doing. You'll be published in books and things, and actually a companion book to the film coming out in early October, which is going to be widely distributed. So obviously the scientists who were part of the expedition will be and their science will be shown and explained. I mean, it's also for you to reach out and just network and meet people. I mean, it sounds corny and obvious, but maybe David has an answer to that as well. David, when you go to, Antarctica and do your papers, what do you do after that so that the general public knows about it?
Yeah, so that's a good question because, and so that's one of the reasons why we're here. And there is a debate in science whether or not, scientists wants to be objective, right? And you want to do your science, publish it, be objective, step away from it and go on to the next project. But I think more, we're coming to the realization that you need to tell the public about your research. And so, I think events like this, movies like this that are very visual and capture the audiences, if you can tag along, have a scientist come along that both takes data, but it also then have talks like this where you can give an outreach and hopefully, all of you go back and say, hey, I saw this wonderful movie. There's a very charismatic scientist there. And then you tell your friends about it. And it's I think it takes grassroots because otherwise, and people end up just hearing the same thing. And as a scientist, it's hard because you you want to do your work as pure as possible. But it definitely is a you want to be an advocate, for your own work. But and you need, sometimes it's hard to because you're worried about being singled out for being political, but it's a message that needs to be heard, and especially in this field. So I wish I knew a better answer because I struggle with this myself. But I think events like this, there's a whole new push at Columbia University to actually speak to places of worship, and this is a place that typically scientists step away from because they, that's a polarizing subject, but. We've made a lot of headway with that, just people going to their local places of worship and saying, hey, I'm a climate scientist. You hear all those, I'm not a climate scientist memes on YouTube, but we are, and so we can talk about it. And when people realize, actually, I met a climate scientist, and they're not that bad. They are out there. And so I think being proactive about it and seeking out sort of community events, it's slow, but maybe possible.
I would just add that, and thank you for the good question, too. It's an important question. First of all, we need to resolve all those issues, unemployment, discrimination, whatever you're looking at, demilitarization, disarmament. We can't just address one. So we've always said we need holistic approaches, and we need people to be willing to work on all of these issues. You can focus on one, but actually be supportive of addressing all of these other issues that, of course, to build a sustainable, survivable human race, we need an Earth, fragile planet we live on, we need to address it all. And I think we need the scientific community, we also need the advocacy community, and we need the political communities. And you have to interact with all of those. We do in Green Cross. Certainly my own office in Washington, D.C. I mean, I love Washington, D.C., I love working there, but you've got to be thick-skinned to deal with the vicious politics that go on, to some extent around climate change, but around everything else we're dealing with today, as you know. So I think social media, too, is very important. I never used to tweet, but my wife has taught me how to tweet, and we do that all the time now. And I think, actually, all of these issues deserve a very proactive use of social media as much as you can.
Thank you, Paul. And David, other questions about any aspects of this, what we've seen tonight? Yes.
Surprise within the expedition. What is your biggest surprise? What was your biggest surprise with the expedition?
For me was the the boat part, the sailing. I was, you know, accustomed to mountaineering and cold temperatures and all that. But the sailing for 6 weeks was just, you know, close to horrible for me and actually most of us. Even the skipper, Ben, was sick quite often. Yeah, that was most surprising. Actually, what you should say that what you see in the film, the scenes and the action were filmed when the weather conditions were reasonably good, sometimes even, you know, almost great. But that was like 5% of the time. 95% of the time, the weather is just horrible and it's cold, it's rainy, it's windy, it's humid. It's not fun. The young lady, maybe, who had a question in orange.
How can you get a film like this to schools for people in, like, my age to see this film and make a difference and learn about more about the climate change?
That's a great question. I'm actually happy to show the film, you know, in schools and universities, colleges, wherever. So come see me after the event. I'll give you my card and email me, and I'll come and do an event at your school. Yeah, great. Cool. Actually, in most of my other expeditions, I had youngsters coming with me, you know, kids from actually the youngest one for a Greenland expedition 10 years ago. Was 4 years old and up to about 16 for the North Pole. For this expedition, it was difficult to have, you know, students or younger people. That's why we picked the two young British soldiers instead. But maybe for a future expedition, you'll come with us. Thank you.
I would add, Luke, that you know, there's a great climate series for youth, film series produced by the writer and producer Lynn Cherry. Who wrote, some of us who are my age and older might remember, wrote a book called The Great Kapok Tree, which is quite famous in about 50 or 60 languages today. But she has a climate series, a film series specifically on climate change issues, and she follows projects of youth, mostly junior high school and high school youth. So I'd urge everyone to take a look at that if they can. I'm sure you can find it on the web.
Other questions? Yes, gentlemen, right here.
Could you talk to us about the logistical aspect of the expedition, and especially were you completely autonomous for the 6 weeks of the journey, or did you have a place where you could refuel and get food and so on? And what would have happened if something were, you know, somebody got hurt or something like that, because you're really far?
Yes, as David said, if we go further, we fell from the edge of the earth. Yeah, it is as far as you can go on the water. I mean, logistics is complicated. You know, I kind of like that. I don't organize trips which are easy to organize. Just to find a boat for an expedition like this, you have to talk to people 2 years ahead of time, because they are just a handful of boats which can do that kind of expeditions. We were entirely autonomous, even though we did stop, on South Georgia Island at a grid weekend, but we would not have needed to. So we stopped at the port there, the main harbor. And yes, we're far from everything. And even if you are at grid weekend and South Georgia, something goes wrong, even more so if something goes wrong at sea, like, you know, breaking something or emergency situation, you are in dire straits. You have to do two things. If it's not too major, you know, the crew, and we have some first aid stuff and some knowledgeable people on board. If it's more complicated, if you need surgery, well, we have painkillers, so at least you can feel good for a few days until we find, hopefully, a cruise ship, a few days sailing and there maybe you can be treated. Coincidentally, nothing happened to me during the expedition. Nothing happened to any of us. And 2 months after returning from the expedition, I hit the pavement walking in the streets of Paris, and I broke my arm, and I now have a medal in my right arm. So you never know where it's going to come from. Yeah. Other questions? All the way up, in yellow.
I have a quick question about the selection of the individuals of the crew. Was there any particular reasoning behind choosing these particular individuals, or was it purely random?
No, random at all. It's very well thought. Because it was some mountaineering, I wanted to be with, you know, my best friend and guide, Ben, François Bernard, and he is the one who brought Géraldine, the snowboarder. I wanted to have, you know, kind of a sport person with us. I think sport people should be more involved in this kind of causes, and you know, they can talk to their constituencies and followers, and so it's great to spread the message. And she certainly did that. She's a champion wingsuit jumper, and did a lot to help us communicate. And because it was a Shackleton-inspired expedition, I definitely wanted to have British citizens with us, hence the group of four, David, Justin, and the two young soldiers, who I explained were the kind of the youngsters of the group, not being able to have young students. So yes, there is a lot of thought. And the crew, I interviewed the crew, as I said, on the boat 2 years before leaving, and I thought they were the best. You need a great boat, but as or more importantly, you know, you need someone who knows, you know, where they're going, who has been there many, many times, and he's been there 19 times. And I thought that was a great crew, and it proved a great one indeed. Thanks. Oh, just next to you, there is another question, and then we'll go up on right there.
Yes, I have a couple of comments. First, congratulations to the organizers of this interesting gathering and for showing the such a well-done film. Look, now let me make two comments. One, you use, in your film comes up, you're using very sophisticated technology to measure changes. What do you expect to have in a year time? Because you already finished that your film in 2014. The COP21 takes place in about a month and a half. Do you expect anything to provide for the COP21 besides your film? And one comment related to your film. Wouldn't be, perhaps, everything is politics. So if you start your film, when your presentation with the comments you made about what is happening with the glaciers in the Antarctic, how the rate that they are disappearing, and somehow, whether in your film, I don't know whether you can change it, but I would do a comparison of the Shackleton time to when you guys went there. I mean, you have pictures to show to begin with. So those two things, how are you planning to use for the upcoming COP21?
Yeah, thanks. Great questions. I mean, we have 40 hours of filming, and obviously not all of that could go in what I wanted to be a short documentary and kind of, you know, pugnacious and not long and boring. As I said earlier, there is this book, and the book goes way beyond what's in the film. Actually, the maps that I mentioned, the glacier measurements and all that are in the book. There is a section on that, and you know, you can compare. It's just incredibly visual. So that's you know, again, the film itself is just to hopefully to make people want to know more and talk more about it, and there is much more to come in the book. I don't know if I answered the entire question.
Comment that I would like to make. You used two soldiers in your film. I think it will be also a great opportunity to make an analogy to the stupidity of war vis-a-vis the role of these young militaries, what they were doing, trying to do something for the climate change.
Yeah, it's a great comment. I mean, certainly these soldiers were happier, even though they were suffering, from seasickness on the boat. They were happier on the boat than they were throwing grenades in Afghanistan or Iraq. The film is going to be shown actually in London in November, and there will be more of a British Army, constituency to watch the film, so it's going to be interesting. But as funny enough, as Ali, one of the two young soldiers said, remember him saying during the expedition, with the soldiers and terrorists in Afghanistan, and you kind of know where the enemy is, but with the bad weather, you never know where it's coming from. So I thought that was interesting quote from him. I like. Yeah, the young, you look young from here, blonde boy.
I just had a question. What was the hardest part in the film, in your trip?
Well, it depends for whom. For let's take the example of the young British soldier who had ear problems because of a IED, explosive device that he suffered from, explosion that he suffered from. So for him, the worst part was anything where he had to keep balance. He could not really, ski. As soon as it was a slope, he would fall literally, even a gentle slope, and would prefer to be on snowshoes instead. For most people, the being on the boat and with these high waves, sometimes 10, 15 feet waves, was the worst part. And the best part was the penguins. You didn't ask a question, but I'm telling you my answer. That was the best part for me and for most people. I'd never seen a penguin before, believe it or not, until I went to this part of Antarctica. All the way up, holding a paper up there.
Hello. Hi. My question is, if you could inspire each and every one of us to do one small thing to make a difference with tackling climate change, what would it be?
David, your turn. And then Paul.
I think public transportation or advocating for public transportation is a big thing. I know in New York City, it's most people get to work on the subway, walking, riding their bikes, so might be preaching to the choir. But I think it's people have this in their mindset that they need to have a car and they need to use it to get to work. And so I think, you might be all doing this yourself, but I think, and I guess maybe this is my broader point, which is, we all have friends that don't really aren't engaged as we are. I mean, you being here, you probably are pretty engaged in the conversation. And so I think just, telling them and talking to them about these issues and not making it taboo. And I think that's probably the small things is just disseminating what you hear here and paying attention to the science and talking about it through public social media.
I mean, there's many things we can do, and as I said earlier, a lot of it's behavioral change, and I think all of us need to question how much energy we use. Part of that goes back to what you said, David. Walk more, bicycle more, promote bicycle lanes. Buy only high efficient cars, so you use less fuel. Don't buy big heavy trucks, pickup trucks, SUVs. It makes a big difference. Recycle. We have an office here in New York that promotes recycling, particularly of
paper, cardboard, and organic waste. And one of the big issues is the difficulty of recycling organic waste here in New York City, for example. It's very difficult to find a place to compost large volumes of organic waste. But think about replacing your heating systems if they're over 20, 25 years old. Any new heating system will save enormous amounts of energy. I think all of those issues are extremely, extremely important. And even though you may think that one person cannot make a difference, I truly believe that each of us can make an enormous difference if we actually focus on these small tasks. And, of course, then you can step out at higher political levels and promote certain pieces of legislation and the like, and push, you know, governments like the United States to make a major stand at COP21 in Paris this December. It will be very important, and make the right initiatives for the sustainable millennium goals, you know, that are coming up, so sustainable development goals. So there's loads you can do. You can do small things like recycling your cans, bottles, and plastics, you know, support deposit laws in other states. We only have 10 states in the United States with deposit laws, and those states recycle 90% of those items, whereas any other state in the country, the best they do is about 35% without financial incentives. So there's many issues like that you can tackle, which will be very important.
Who? Oh, yeah. Here in white.
And you spoke about the challenge, the big weather. The big weather and bringing back your whole team. Now, this only is one of your expeditions. Others include going to the North Pole and also climbing Mount Vincent, the highest spot in the Antarctic. Which of these expeditions presented you with the greatest challenge and the best memories?
Well, I'd like to answer that saying the greatest challenge will be, and best memories will be from the next one I'm preparing. That's the easy way out of the answer. Probably the most physically difficult one was the North Pole, even though the altitude is virtually zero. It was very, very cold and humid, and you get, you know, immersed in a real dumpy cold all the time, and you have a risk of falling through the ice literally at every step. So that was very memorable. And the best memories would be from, for this kind of expedition in a polar world or, you know, cold part of the world, would be just being in the middle of Antarctica, in the middle of the continent, and the scenery there is just incredible. There is nothing, just silence, nothing in the sky, no sound, no one. It's just the best memories for me. Yes, there is a younger, yes.
Got the wrong buttons.
Okay. First, I wanted to thank you for the movie because it was very interesting and it was very good. And I wanted to ask two questions. First, the scuba diver. It occurred to me that he didn't have. Well, he did, but he didn't have much equipment and. I know that the water over there must be really cold and freezing, and, like, he had his mouth out, so how did he not, like, freeze in that type of water? And also, the second question would be the photographer or the filmmaker, is did he follow the woman that was snowboarding was he also snowboarding or is he skiing? Was he like, because it must have been hard for him, like climbing and snowboarding and stuff and taking videos and pictures at the same time?
Yes, a great question. I'll start by answering the second one. Actually, Bertrand Delapierre was the main cameraman, even though we all helped and did some video vignettes here and there. He's the main cameraman and the director for the film. And he's a true hero of that film. He did everything that we did and that Geraldine did especially, and not only followed her, but he went up there in the mountains before her, and you know, had to remove his gloves and film her as she was climbing up and snowboarding down. So he did actually everything she did and much more, trying to film that. And that's really true of most mountaineering film that you can see. You know, the ones coming out soon. The people you don't see are the real true heroes of this film. And a question about the scuba diver, Justin. Well, first I can tell you the dive was not very long. It was, you know, about 15, 20 meter deep max. But yes, the water is cold. It's hardly a few degrees above freezing temperature. Sometimes it can be actually below freezing point. As you may know, salt water freezes at about minus 2 C. And he has a, you know, what we call a dry suit. So it's not a typical wetsuit you would use when you go scuba diving in the Turks and Caicos or Caymans or Tahiti. You don't have water between the skin and the dry suit. So it keeps you really warm. And unfortunately, yes, the part around, you know, the mouth piece, the regulator, has to be exposed, and that gets cold. But again, it was a few minutes, you know, 5-10 minutes dive. It was not an hour dive. So that's why he was able to make it. Right here.
Great adventure. Congratulations. Fantastic. Could you maybe comment more about the science, the types of samples that you took, the crew took? What are the buoys doing? Are they still floating around? What kind of data they're collecting? And in general, what's the time frame and the expectation of getting the results?
Yes, I'll briefly answer that, and I'll let David maybe complement with a kind of science, which is, you know, even though he was not with us, he's doing that kind of thing. Yeah, we deployed 11 floats, seven at the surface and four going deep into the ocean at about 2,000 meters. They stay there for a few days, and they go up every few days at the surface, emit their data. They do that for about 2 years or more. You know, it's about the life of the battery, and all this data is collected by scientists and eventually add to the database of data that they have about this part of the world. And the great thing with the trip we did is that, you know, literally no one goes there, and even though there are about 3,500 floats at one point in time in the world, in all these oceans, there are only the few that we dropped in this particular part of the world. So that was particularly interesting to these scientists to measure currents, surface currents, but also currents deeper in the ocean, as you know, Antarctic and other parts of the world is melting. That has an impact on the temperature of the ocean and all these currents around the around Antarctica, which are influencing the all the other seas in the world. David, you want to add to that?
Yeah, so my cruise to East Antarctica this past year, we also dropped off some of these similar floats. They're called Argo floats, and there are 3,600, and they replenish several, several a year. So especially every cruise to the Southern Ocean, they want to pepper them. And as you may know, if I can get my direction here doing it backwards, the winds around Antarctica, there are these westerlies, and that's why the ocean's so intense and the currents are so strong, is because you just have this unimpeded current that can swirl all the way around the continent. And so it's important to put these in there, and then they'll drift westward, as you maybe noticed in Zoe made a little animation there of where the drifters went. They drifted eastward. So these are really important for many reasons. One is the data itself, so we can look at trends. Satellites can only see the surface of the atmosphere, or the surface of the ocean, down to a few millimeters depth. But what's important is actually below, especially in the polar oceans. If you go out to the ocean here, it might be warm at the surface, but you go down below, it gets colder. But that's the case for the mid-latitude and the tropical sea surface or oceans. But in the poles, the warm water is actually below, and this is where it's storing a lot of the heat. And this is the heat that melts the ice. And so satellites don't help us at all, actually. They help the models, and they're good with winds and ocean currents. But actually, to get the heat, to understand the heat that is coming up and melting these ice shelves and the glaciers, you have to put an instrument in the water, and it's got to go down at depth. A lot of the ice shelves and the glaciers are grounded up to 1,500 meters deep. So, One World Trade Center is 550 meters high, I think. So when you go out there and you look up at it, think, there's three times as high, and that's how deep grounded, how much ocean there is beneath these ice caps and ice shelves. So you really need these floats in order to measure that subsurface warmth. And without that, we don't have the science. We don't have the data to do the science we need. So there's kind of a cool mode of these where they can live under the sea ice for lots of times. Remember, in the winter, the sea ice grows, and then they can't come up to surface and transmit their data. So they go down, and they have an upward-looking sonar, and they say, there's sea ice, don't come up. And then they just basically float around, and they have a clock, and they can say, let's try again. And eventually they'll come up and transmit all their data that they've kept. So they're pretty cool things, totally indispensable. We need more Lukes to put more sensors out in the Southern Ocean.
Okay. It seems sort of intuitive that human impact, industrialization, and so forth would be a factor in climate change. I apologize for really incredibly asking for a simplified answer to what must be an incredibly complicated question, but is there any way to deal with sort of the most obvious skepticism, which would be that human impact is a small component, that naturally occurring factors. Is there some way that you can attribute, say, 10 degrees or 5 degrees of change, 10% of that is human, more than 100% is human? Is there some way to answer that?
Well, unless I'm wrong, I think it's, 25% of the carbon dioxide in the atmosphere is traced to human activity, and most all of that is the past 100 years, and that's a fact. I mean, we can trace different kinds of CO2, even if you just say molecule, to different activities. So, these are facts. I guess, for my part, it's just showing and repeating the facts and the new facts and the new science. And I think I can see that over the last maybe 5 years, you don't see anyone on TV anymore saying that climate change is a hoax like we did just a few years ago. So I think it's changing. I think here are some, Republicans, to name them, who are actually admitting that there is a major problem due to human activity. So I think it's changing, but it's just hammering the facts all the time. I mean, if someone is totally, total ideologue, probably won't be able to change his or her mind, but some people are more open than they would like to admit. Paul, have you come across any?
In Washington, there are certainly climate skeptics still. So I think the question is very fair. you ask. I'm sure in other capitals it's the same around the world. I usually say to people they should look at the summary reports of the IPCC, the International Panel on Climate Change. Those are still pretty difficult to wade through, even the sort of executive summaries. So I think it takes groups like ourselves, NGOs, environmental experts, and scientists to really try to explain those in very simple fashion. And I think you can do that by pulling out a variety of statistics. We know that the Earth is much warmer today than it was for millennia in the past. We know the oceans are warming. We know that the glaciers are all melting. We know that the Arctic and Antarctic ice flows are melting. All of that is actually measured and proven. And the IPCC, if you read that report, every sort of bald statement they make, they put, you know, very likely, highly likely, moderately likely. They try to give a sort of probability as to how much agreement there is. So I think it's actually very fairly done. And I think it just needs more of us talking about this. And as I mentioned earlier to this gentleman over here, we need to tweet out the basic facts. We need to blog on this more. And we need more of us talking in groups before skeptics up in Congress and elsewhere. Because it's inevitable. This Earth is changing dramatically, much faster than we ever predicted. And if we don't make immediate changes and serious changes, this Earth will be extremely difficult to live on in another century or so, if not sooner. So we really are facing, in the worst case, questions of extinction even. But I think it's certainly highly likely in the next few decades that we'll see more extreme weather, therefore more issues around food security, more issues around desertification, more issues around migration. Now, of course, that is turned into violence and conflict. If you think the migration today in Europe is bad, just wait, a few years and see how worse it gets simply due to weather, let alone violence itself. So this is a very, very serious issue. I think we also, if you look, 100 years down the road, none of the coastal cities like New York City will practically be livable unless we take serious precautions in the next half century to build the dikes against the sea rise that's happening. And that's been proven for years and years and years. So I think we just have to speak truth to power, as they say, and people eventually are listening, as Luke has pointed out.
If I may add, I think also children, and I'll take your question, or we'll take your question right after, children are very important. I've yet to meet a skeptic, child. No one under the age of 18, 20 has ever come to me saying, I don't believe in climate change. Usually these come from adults, and even their children sometimes are in conflict with them because they just disagree and agree with the science. Lady in red, if you have a question for one of us.
What do you think about Shell drilling in the Arctic for oil? Antarctic, sorry.
Yeah, I mean, personally, I think doing anything, mechanical, industrial in the Arctic is just terrible. Well, there is the activity which has been going on for years in Alaska, just at the edge of the Arctic, but going into the Arctic itself underwater is just a recipe for a disaster at some point when even if all the known Arctic resources were to be exploited, it would be only less than 2% of the oil consumption of the next few years. So it's a ridiculously small amount for major problems which would occur if someone drills there, as it's unfortunately some exploration going on. I hope it never reaches a stage of actual industrial production, but we'll see. My vote, I'm sure. Yes, lady in black there.
I'm also actually a student at Columbia University, and I studied biotechnology. And I had two questions. How was your general overview on the well-being of the animals, firstly? And then second, the climate change is going to be affecting health as well. So what about doing another adventure where we actually look at climate change in terms of the global health and how it's going to affect different things, for example, malaria and different perspectives of the human health, which is going to be very important, especially in this coming year due to ENSO phases happening.
Yes, actually, when you come out, if we have any books left, I have a book on Greenland, an expedition I did a few years ago, and we actually looked at wildlife and bird migration and how climate change is affecting wildlife, birds in particular, how they move north more and more because the temperatures are rising. We looked at polar bear populations and all that. So that's a theme I do like as well. And along with the Inuit population in Greenland and in Canadian Arctic as well. So I've done two books about these subjects before. I don't know if David would like to add something, I'm sure.
Yeah, just since we have a project working with Greenlandic people, Luke talked to this about when you just go there once and you take one measurement, you can't tell change. But you go there and you talk to the Greenlandic people and the elders there, and I mean, they notice change. Most of them are fishermen these days. Meanwhile, they used to be hunters, and that's because the sea ice season is much shorter. Now you only get a good 3 months, and most of their hunting comes off. They use the sea ice as a platform. So, the whole way of life has changed, and so now they all have boats and, that kind of sled dogs in Greenland, they're very expensive to feed. And so if you're not using them, because they're used for hunting, if you're not using them, then you don't have them anymore until you buy a skidoo, and then, now you have gas and all these things. And so it's, their culture's very, in communities at the crossroads of sort of the old way of life and the new, the new post sea ice life. And so I think it's a good story there too, is sort of how they've been impacted by it and what they're doing to pass on their knowledge to the next generation and keep their culture alive.
Actually, I have a friend in Greenland near Ilulissat who was forced to kill his dogs just because they are of no use now. And it costs a lot of money to feed them, and they literally kill the dogs, which is obviously sad.
I would add too, you might want to look at the American Public Health Association website, APHA. The Public Health Associations, the American one is the biggest in the world. It's a very good site, very good group in Washington, D.C. that we work with actually quite actively. And they also participate in the World Federation of Public Health Association, WFPHA. And we've put on several plenary sessions in the last conferences on global security, sustainability, and public health. And I think you could probably find the presentations and the PowerPoints from those. It's all very interrelated. So we're not just talking climate change. We're talking all the impact, the public health impacts. We're also talking issues of violence and war, and everything is really interrelated. So you have to look at these larger macro questions really holistically. But the public health associations actually do this quite well. Disease, all the rest, biosecurity issues. Yeah.
Maybe we'll take a couple more questions before we end the session. Yes, in white over there, left. Doesn't work. I think you have to press something on the.
Hey, hi, Luke, I have a little bit of a devil's advocate question for you. So you are a technologist, right? And do you think in practice it's the natural technological progress that's going to solve the climate change, the progress in solar energy, the progress in food science. I understand from the personal perspective, people should, tweet and take an Uber pool instead of an Uber X, right? And but you know, the economist in me is worried that, that governments will actually try to use today's technologies to get into this 2 degrees Celsius target, which is super expensive, you know. And the you know, the IPCC estimates that the sea level is going to rise 30 centimeters by 2100, but you know, the technology in the next 100 years is going to, you know, change a lot, right? So you know, should we focus on the technological change kind of first, and everything else after?
Yeah, thanks. And I'm sure our friends here may have also their thoughts. Simple answer is, you know, I'm not too optimistic. Obviously, I'm trying to do my share and more. But I do think that if we solve our problems related to the impact of climate change, I think it will come mostly from technology. And it is already coming from technology. I'm an investor in Silicon Valley in a startup which is doing electric motors, more advanced electric motors for cars and buses and whatnot. And that makes a difference. So yeah, personally, I think technology is going to be in general, the solutions. Some will work, some won't work, and you know, we'll try 100, and one or two will work. I think some are very expensive, like removing CO2 from the atmosphere, and that's probably not going to work before a long time. And as there's a breakthrough, solar is obviously a great great solution and a lot of improvements. So that's my view in a nutshell. Yes, up there.
I wanted to know if you, do you hear me? Yeah. If it's possible to put the movie on YouTube to be able to show it to our kids. They cannot come here, and to show it maybe through schools.
Yes, eventually it will be, probably beginning of next year. In the fall, it's going to be picked up by hopefully a few, you know, TV, cable, internet TV channels. So I've, with my distributor, and I own the rights to the film, so I can do what I want with it, but I prefer to show it in festivals and, you know, bring some attention to the film until COP21, and after that it's going to be widely distributed. You know, you'll see it on Netflix and YouTube and everywhere. Yeah, thanks. Okay, one last question, and then we will have to stop, or my security bill will be very, very expensive. Maybe no more questions. No more? Great. Well, thank you very much to all. I should say my mom would be very proud of me being here at the UN today with all of you. She's never sailed before. She's never taken the plane, and she's never walked in on ice. So that's quite a treat to be here tonight. Thank you all. Yeah, are there a few books left or not? Yeah, I've this new book coming up, but I've also brought a few copies of a book on Greenland that I wrote a few years ago. So some of you can, you know, have one, maybe the youngsters, if there are some, or kind of a one per family. I think there are a few up there. And Charles, you want to bring one to David here? That would be great. Thank you all. Thanks.